The conference here in Victoria now turns towards the nexus between ambition, innovation and imagination, threats, both perceived and real, and to the heart of industrial commercialization. We are at the intersection between strategic choice and operational imperatives driven by cost and shaped by budget. Of course, we're talking about technology and how technology drives naval and maritime doctrine and operation.
It also shapes
the outcomes of conflict as well as the means to both prevent it and avoid it. War has a long history that dates back to the dawn of civilization. We have come a long way since then. Historians have pointed to 7 technologies that have transformed the very nature of warfare. They include drones, unmanned aerial vehicles, both surface and subsurface, that now enable governments to elect to deploy weapons of war at considerable distance, removed from the threat or proximity of danger. Fly-by-wire technology that has brought greater precision and handling as a result of computers embedded in platforms. Submarines. They've come an awful long way since the Civil War. Tomahawk missiles. Stealth, both in aircraft and in ship design. And now we're starting to see space-based weapons, both to attack Earth-based targets, as well as intercept and disable missiles traveling through space. The evolution of naval warfare has not lain stagnant over these past years either. Major technological advances have served to fundamentally alter the conduct of naval operations. For example, the introduction of gyroscopic compasses to improve fire control precisions, gas turbines increasing speed, power, and reliability, battery technology that has driven changes in weapons design and size. Can't forget the evolution of at-sea replenishment that provided navies the ability to extend reach, duration, sustainment of operations virtually anywhere in the world. Machinery automation and the impact on not only naval operations, but its transfer into commercial technology that results in reduced manning and increased damage control capability. And today, as the Caribbean is getting hammered with yet another hurricane, we look to weather forecasting and the significant changes in technology and alerting populations and maritime forces. And then finally, scuba not only provided us all with the ability to begin to work underwater, but it introduced a whole new warfare area for maritime operations. This panel will take a look at the next set of game changers that lie ahead of us that promise to dramatically change the maritime operating space. First up will be David Hazen from National Defense Headquarters, who will look at linking the celestial and terrestrial and the impact that space provides to navies. He will be followed by George Galasori from the United States, who will be exploring the rise of autonomous vehicles. Hitting cleanup, back to the baseball metaphor just to keep reminding our American friends of we are the North, will be Professor Alexandre Sheldon Play from France. As this panel presents their comments and findings, I'll pose 3 questions for all of us to think about during these presentations. Is technology and cost finally pushing over the top the notion of tiered navies and puts navies into categories that will begin to fundamentally drive interoperability ambition and impact coalition interoperability structures and abilities for navies to operate together? Second question, what, if any, are the impacts on potential rules of engagement or changes in doctrine that will emerge from the technologies that these presenters will brief to you? And finally, What social impact might the turn of autonomy and artificial intelligence have on the legitimacy and moral impact of conflict? Here we go. David, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Commodore. It's really fun to be asked to do this because I've spent 30 years of my life going to see, I'm an engineer, so going to see breaking things, fixing them, and now in the last 2 years, I've been transported into the joint ISR world. So I'm coming at this as somebody who spent a lot of time at sea, but now worries about things flying around in the air. Caveat up front, I work with the Department of National Defense, but the opinions expressed here are mine. They're not necessarily reflective of government policy. I'm going to be a little bit speculative, and I'd appreciate your consideration that it's Dave talking. It's not the department. So, growing up in the 1960s, two big TV influences. First one was The Undersea World of Jacques Cousteau. The second was Star Trek. The first of these took me to sea for 30 years. The second has now got me worrying about things in space. And this is a great time to pull the two together. Before we start talking about the effect of space on the sea, let's just talk a little bit about the effect of sea on space. And that's because space is a global commons like the high seas, and many of the rules are similar to what we see in terms of UNCLOS, consensus-based behaviors, the platforms are sovereign territory, so there are a lot of similarities between the governance of space and the governance of sea. Granted, we've got several hundred years of understanding how to work together at sea. We've got about 60 years of understanding how to work together in space, but there are a number of remarkable similarities. That said, the topic is back the other way, the effect of space on the sea. And what I'm going to talk about this morning is what I see as a coming revolution, small r maybe, and that has to do with the democratization or the commercialization of space. Space was once the realm of wealthy and powerful nation states. You had to have a certain size economy, a certain technical prowess to consider putting satellites up to access the data that's available from them. But now space is increasingly open to new organizations, down to and including high schools. This is the result of the nexus of SmallSat, MicroSat, and NanoSat technologies, basically low-cost buses to put sensing in space, the advent of commercial launch vehicles, and in parallel, the development of big data analytics. Putting this together means there's much lower cost to get capability on orbit, and we now have much more effective ways to deal with that huge volume of data that has been coming down, but even more will be coming down with the number of launches that are predicted. So from the commercial sector, kinds of platforms, communications. This is not new. We've had commercial communications for a long time. We have things like Iridium that cover global coverage, provide global coverage for personal comms, and then the big players up in geo. Commercial AIS, I think most organizations dealing with maritime domain awareness are tapping into commercial AIS. We see ADS-B is not too far behind. For those who don't know, ADS-B is a rough AIS equivalent for commercial aircraft, and it's what the civilian aviation authorities are moving to in order to track and manage commercial aviation. And commercial Earth observation, from assisting farmers with optimal watering patterns to predicting growth, to predicting floods. In addition to the platform pieces, value-added analytical services, cloud computing, the widespread availability of very powerful tools like Amazon Web Services and data analytics capability. The result is that there are a number of commercial entities now bringing forth propositions, and I'm not a businessman, but they seem like pretty viable propositions, to put up private satellite constellations with an associated data cloud and value-added analytic services, fully funded by the private sector. And depending on the predictions you look at, this could result in up to 3,000 new satellites over the next 5 to 7 years. And depending on the latitude you're looking at, a prediction that every spot on Earth will be imaged by something approximately every 20 minutes. This is huge. So what? The impact on maritime communications, connect from pretty much everywhere. We've got that now, it's only going to improve. High latitudes are still problematic because the bulk of satellites are in the mid-latitude belt, but that connectivity is there. And reliable and reasonably secure communications compared with HF. Back when I first was going to sea, you made a call ashore over HF, everybody in a 500-mile radius heard you. So the result of this is effectively continuous contact with ships that are at sea. It enables ship and cargo tracking. Ship tracking we're accustomed to now with AIS. Cargo tracking, at least at a container level, has been happening for years. Back in the midst of time when I was working with the Bedford Institute, they shipped a cargo of a container load of ocean tracking buoys. One of the techs left one on. They had it pop up on their chart, which was a good thing because the shipping company lost the container. And so this is 25 years ago. My colleagues were calling the shipping company, yeah, it's on this dock. Please go pick it up. What you're seeing now in the literature is puck-sized container tracking capability that you attach to containers. So not only you know what the ship is, but if it's your container, services are starting to come online and say, yeah, you can follow the thing all the way along. Higher expectations for pre-arrival reporting, which is not a bad thing because commerce depends on being able to get ships in and out of port quickly. The fact that ships can pre-file all of their arrival reports, the border authorities have a sense of what's coming at them, can sort out where their concerns are, mean that commercial schedules can be maintained. And could you imagine something like the Maersk Tripoli coming into port and in the old days happened to sit there while customs inspectors went through the entire ship and every manifest to look at it? The speed of commerce today can't allow that, and the advanced reporting is one of the enablers. And self-reporting of ship systems, enabling just-in-time engineering support. Again, we're seeing this first on the commercial side, but even now pressure on the naval side to reduce the at-sea staff to adopt condition-based maintenance. That requires that ship systems are actually reporting back to a central authority to say, okay, this generator is going to need somebody looking at it in the next 2 weeks. Please make sure that you've got a team at the next port visit to come aboard and deal with that. This enables reduced manning, higher business efficiency. You can discuss whether or not, compared to the old days when ships were very self-sufficient for maintenance, whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, but at least on the commercial side, it's reducing those shipping costs and achieving higher efficiency. In that same vein, it also, in an emergency, enables telemedicine. So my dad was on the Queen Victoria a few years ago, going trans-Pacific and had a fall. He got taken into the sick bay. It was amazing. They took his x-rays. They had them sent back to a hospital on shore. The ship's physician was consulting with specialists on shore. And by the time they made port, everything had been sorted. In the old days, it would have been put the injured person in a hospital seat and kind of keep them stable until you could enable access to better expertise. The next impact is on passage making. precise navigation. Again, we've all gotten very used to GPS. I think a few of us in the room maybe remember the days before that, manually dialing in time delays on Loran A or using transit systems that only gave you a fix every 4 hours. Nowadays, that precise navigation is taken for granted. Storm, ice, and current avoidance, or if you're an East Coast sailor and wanting to get a lift across the Gulf Stream, knowing where the Gulf Stream is so you can get that 3 or 4 knot boost. Vessel traffic management beyond the range of shore-based radar. We've got friends here from Norway. Their vessel traffic management zone is well offshore, and they manage that through a combination of shore-based radar and satellite reporting. And if we ever get to drone ships, not for or against it, but certainly the satellite-based communications would be a critical enabler for that. This is the concept from a few years ago of trans-Pacific ships basically being launched from one side of the ocean, coming across with minimal manning, and a landing crew being put aboard the pilot station at the other end. The maritime security perspective, certainly as a result, we have much better knowledge of who's approaching our shores and what they're bringing with them. Decluttering the plot, separating the knowns from the unknowns. 99% of traffic is just people getting about their business. The challenge for maritime security practitioners is where are that 1% that need that closer look and maintaining custody of that plot so that you know, okay, those are the guys we've got to watch for, or those are the people who are behaving in a strange way. Somebody transiting that all of a sudden is loitering around a spot. Got it, thank you. Pattern of life assessment, detection and response to SAR events, spotting pollution plumes, and monitoring of fishing and surveying activities. With response to yesterday, thinking more about big fishing vessels, not necessarily the little inshore ones. This is probably not a new slide, it's a snapshot of what's available from AIS. That I got from a colleague in Halifax. The red dots are reports of informed into tracks, yellow are other receipts. The big piece is that's a lot of data from AIS receipts. Similarly, work that we're doing in the lab with RadarSat-2 and AIS, auto-detecting ships and cross-correlating, just for a little bit of this is the kind of picture we get out of synthetic aperture radar right now, so you're not seeing a photo quality example of a ship. It's big blob, little blob, but big blob of a certain size correlated with an AIS report. So, for every upside, there's a downside. What's out there? First off, there were widely hypothesized reporting for Somalia that pirates were taking their cues from AIS reports. For the purpose of this discussion, it doesn't matter whether or not they were actually doing it. That technical capacity was there, and it wasn't being used in Somalia, somebody else could. As we get more information available in commercial space, there's a risk that illegal activities could be enabled by it. In the same vein, knowledge of where naval ships are, where patrol ships are, could start to be accessed to basically evade the patrols. If you're thinking about counter-drug activities in the Caribbean, for example, knowing where those major platforms are, that data could be used by the bad guys. And the last one is potential loss of traditional communication skills. Now, aside from navies, who really practices HF and maintaining a DR plot anymore? We can't become too dependent on the technology, and that's certainly a risk. So, a couple things that aren't going to change. It's still going to be a really big ocean. We tend to focus on choke points, Straits of Malacca, Juan de Fuca, tons of spots. But the reality is, once you're out on the high seas, it's a big ocean with a lot of space in between. speed, time, and distance isn't going to change. Ships move relatively slowly in the language of aircraft and cyber communications. And it's still a tough life at sea. Weather's still going to be there. Still got to deal with icing and so on. So my conclusion, advances in space technology, particularly those driven by commercial space and data analytics, are going to continue to have a significant impact on life at sea through improvements in communications, voyage planning, traffic management, and emergency response. The sea, however, will remain a harsh mistress. And just giving credit where it's due, I have some help putting the slides together. So thank you.
So that's the perspective I'm coming at this with. So there's a couple of things I think we all can agree on. There is an expanding, exploding use of unmanned systems worldwide in militaries. In the U.S., we have very strong policy direction on that. There are evolutionary changes happening with unmanned systems. There are revolutionary changes that are starting to emerge. There is a compelling rationale, which I'll talk about, for making autonomous systems more autonomous, and that the art of this is making weaponized unmanned systems we actually can use. And there's a wide range of specialties in the delegation here. If I'm pitching this to anyone in particular, it's industry. And the pitch is to industry is to build, design and build autonomous systems the military can actually use. So we have some questions that were teed up for our panel. The first one was talk about recent developments in the Indo-Pacific region and talk about which ones were maybe overhyped and which ones were underappreciated. I think autonomous systems are a bit underappreciated. And then how nations can adapt to these technological changes that we're facing. And then finally, for unmanned systems, how will they fully interact with manned systems? And that's really going to be the crux of what I talk with you all today. So talking about a plan, within our Department of Defense, we have several services, and within those services, we have lobbies. The Department of Defense several years ago decided that autonomous systems touch all the services and all of the lobbies that we needed a plan. So they developed this unmanned systems roadmap. It's reissued every several years, and a new one is coming out this year. You can see here what some of the key tenets of that are. Oh, by the way, the U.S. Navy is coming out with its first unmanned system roadmap this year. So there is a lot of policy and direction of necessity with unmanned systems. Again, there's been more heat than light on offset strategy, so I thought I'd address that as it touches unmanned systems. Secretary Wirt talked about why we have offset strategies, and I think this quote captures very well what he was talking about. So we have a third offset strategy that begs the question, well, what were the first two? So the 50s was the new look, 70s was the offset strategy, and today's called the Defense Innovation Initiative. So the first offset strategy evolved in the 1950s, where we could not match the Soviet Union tank for tank or man for man. So the idea was to be able to stop them with nuclear weapons if necessary. 20 years later, the Soviet Union had caught up, and they had nuclear parity. So we said, if we're going to win, we need to have these kind of technologies that can help win the war. We never did fight the Soviet Union through that, but we fought a Soviet proxy army in Iraq in Operation Desert Storm. Again, our competitors have caught up. As former Defense Secretary Hagel said in this quote, so now there's a need for a third offset strategy. There are five, if we have more time with this brief, I put up what most military guys do in a brief, but the Greek architecture, there'd be five pillars that would start out with third offset strategy, Defense Innovation Initiative, and pillars that talk about things like operational concepts and war gaming and other things. But for the technology piece of this is what we're talking about. Human-machine collaboration and combat teaming is what looms the largest. So these are the elements of what Secretary Wirt very often talks about with this human-machine collaboration, which is what we're after today. It's assisted human operations, advanced human-machine combat teaming, and network-enabled semi-autonomous systems. So this is really the crux and the direction of where our DoD is going with autonomous systems to make them more useful. So there are challenges for autonomous systems. Former Vice Chief of Staff of the Air Force and later the Supreme Allied Commander, Air Force General Breedlove, said the most critical problem we have in the United States Air Force is manning our unmanned systems. Think about that for a while. So why is that an issue or problem? This is what the roadmap says about the cost drivers in the budget. The largest cost driver in all of DoD and within the U.S. Navy is manning for total operational costs. So therefore, there is this tremendous drive to make unmanned systems more autonomous. I just put up one slide here. If a longer time, we'd have a lot more, but you can see just the cost of military manpower in the U.S. DoD, and this is why the number of soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines is decreasing, so it's a huge problem. So there's a tremendous drive to make systems more autonomous, fewer people, fewer humans in the loop. Well, there's a dark side. And if some of you in this room are old enough to have seen this movie without your parents taking you back in 1968, but wasn't this prescient? And that's continued. We started with, and we're not even talking about Frankenstein or the Terminator kind of things. We're talking about more elegant autonomous systems. You remember the movie Her, with the gentleman and his cell phone? And who's seen Ex Machina, a show of hands? A chilling movie. Because why? Well, 2001, the Space Odyssey was pretty binary. Hal says, you try to turn me off and I will kill you. Ex Machina is all about artificial intelligence and the Turing tests, and Caleb, the hero of the movie, trying to convince Ava that they actually have a romantic interest, and very bad things happen to Caleb. So, let me go back just a second. So, if we had more time, I would talk to you about some of the perceptions, and as Admiral Swift said last night, sometimes perception's as important as reality, out in the public about autonomous systems and the bad things they can do. So there have been editorials and op-eds in The Economist, and The Wall Street Journal, and The New York Times saying, you know, these are things we need to watch. And so you say, well, those are kind of wonky, palm mill things. What do we care about them? Because the technologists get it, right? They're not worried about autonomous systems. Here's a quote from Alex Garland, the writer and director of Ex Machina. And look at some of the people he's quoting as having very big concerns about autonomous systems. And again, that's what those of us in the military and industry need to address to make systems that allay some of those concerns, or legitimate concerns. So how do you design the right degree of autonomy? This is what the DoD Defense Science Board said, and I've highlighted or bolded some of those things just to key in on them of what our Defense Science Board is telling us we need to do with our autonomous systems. So how do we design the right degree of autonomy? Just put a couple of bullets up here. There's a hierarchy of tasks that they need to do, and sometimes we forget about the most basic tasks, navigation and communication, so those are important there. There are many people in the design process of these, and these are some of the different specialties that come to designing unmanned systems. And again, there are many people who play in this, bringing them together, because each one of those professions would design an autonomous system much differently than the other ones. And then, for the military, I've got friends in the requirements business here, just to write a request for a proposal and turn it over to industry and say, build it, will not work. You've got to have constant interaction with a human factors engineering, human systems integration methodology. And then it's not to over-allocate time and money to the platform itself. Sometimes we build the platform over years, and then the last couple of months we said, oh, let's put the brains in the platform. It doesn't work so well. And then finally, develop a CONOPS for how we want this autonomous system to work. Here are some of the aircraft and the autonomous systems that the U.S. Navy is currently having work together. If you don't design a CONOPS in the beginning for how they're going to work together, then how could you possibly design the autonomous system to do what you want it to do in a useful way? So let's talk about the future a little bit, which is why we're here. This is what the Defense Science Board talked about as to why we want autonomous systems and what we want them to do. So let me give you an analogy that all of us experience in our personal lives. What kind of car do you want to drive in the future? Something your parents drove? A completely driverless car that takes you where you want to go with AI? Or something with augmented intelligence where you're in control? And we can certainly address this in the Q&A, but I think some of the zeal initially for driverless cars has calmed down. And these are just some headlines. You can Google any one of these headlines and we'll pull up an article in the Wall Street Journal or somewhere else, but people are now starting to ask real questions like, is this really, really what we want? Extrapolate that to the military use, particularly of lethal autonomous systems, and again, the public are asking some very serious questions. Do you have control of these things? Can we trust these things to do what you want to do? Vice Chairman of our Joint Chiefs of Staff talked about what the DoD is about to design autonomous systems to actually be used, and again, I'm pitching mainly to you in industry to say, these are ones we can use where there are a lot that we won't be able to use. So we talked about augmented intelligence. What would it actually look like if we had it? Because I think that's the key question. So let's talk about autonomous systems that are used for surveillance. Does the autonomous vehicle going across the Pacific Ocean just give you hours and hours of video? Or does it tell you only when it locates a vessel? And if it does locate a vessel, Are these some of the things that it can tell you? And then once it's surveilled that area, what does it do next? Do you have to decide, or does it help you? Does it say, well, maybe I should look at this area because of various things that that I've discovered? And then does it remind the operator that it's running out of fuel? I can't tell you how many board games I've sat in on tabletops where someone says, hey, my Global Hawk's not telling me anything anymore. And someone said, yeah, that's because it ran out of fuel and it's now at the bottom of the ocean. So those are things to think about. Probably more importantly for lethal autonomous systems, if you're after a target, what is the level of confidence that that autonomous system, that that is the person? What's that based on? Facial recognition, voice recognition, who that person's hanging out with, etc. I'll just flash these very quickly in each of the time. And then what's the potential for collateral damage to family members, cohorts, or other people? And then what are the potential impacts? So these are the questions that the autonomous system needs to be posing to the operator for it to be as useful as we'd like it to be. So just wrapping up, and this is, I'm not the public affairs officer for our lab, but it's easy to say, well, these are great theories. Put your money where your mouth is. Our lab is a model called Navy Working Capital Fund, which means there's no line item in our Department of Defense budget for the lab. So our people are out there, just like you in industry, looking for work and trying to work on things that are going to have a future. So this is just a snapshot of the kind of autonomous programs we're working on, things where we've had to invest our own very limited funds. I know Commodore Williams called out Hammer. Hammer is a program where we have a surface, an air, and a subsurface vehicle all tied together with one common control station. But again, the point is we're putting our money where our mouth is and looking at these things as things for the future. Our former Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, back when he was a Navy Flag Officer, wrote this article on Naval Institute Proceedings. I think that counts for our lab infrastructure and also for Mr. Hazen's and the lab infrastructure of all of the nations here that we will never lose tomorrow's wars in the lab. So happy to take questions when the time comes. And in our public broadcasting system, when they show you a show, they say, and if you'd like to learn more about this, we'll take you to a book or something. Again, the paper that's associated with this briefing, or an article we did for Naval Institute Proceedings talking about the promise and the challenges of autonomy. So thank you very much for letting me share these views with you.
Well, thank you very much for Canada and Jim to invite me to this very informative conference. I am pleased to address this issue. I had the opportunity over the past 15 years to visit Russia annually, first to do a Cold War research together with a former U.S. naval attaché in Moscow, and more recently on Arctic convoy issues. So I have had the opportunity to talk with the Russian retired naval people for the past 15 years.
Next slide.
So we have all been impressed by those, let's say, apparently surprise cruise missile attacks by the Russians from the Caspian Sea starting in October of 2015, and those attacks have been repeated, as we know, in November, in December of 15 from a Kilo submarine in the Mediterranean, and more recently by the same class of corvettes from the Mediterranean, both in August and in September of 2016. And they apparently came out of the blue.
Next slide.
Oh, I have the control.
Yes.
So we have looked at those missiles, the caliber, and we have looked at them as if they were a new kind of missile which had been cooked in the perhaps in the aftermath of the Ukrainian crisis. But actually, those missiles, the caliber family, the club family, actually had been advertised in shows for quite a long time, starting in IDEX in Abu Dhabi in 1993. And actually, the export version had been exported before. So those missiles are not really new. Next slide. And those are those spectacular images from, I would say, I'm a bit nasty to the US Navy, but I would call it a true LCS, because this is really a very small platform which is well armed with its eight similar analog to a Tomahawk on the small platform. Next slide. And what is interesting also is to note that Russia and President Putin had already started is what we could call the caliber diplomacy before this attack from the Caspians. And we have to see that he had shown personally boost missiles to the president of Azerbaijan, who doesn't look extremely happy, and the same corvettes had visited Iran. So very obviously the Russians are using boost cruise missiles to impress their neighbors. Next slide. And if we look at a Russian analysis of this strike, we see from a Russian analyst at the Russian presidency that he described those strikes as a demonstration, so it's a bit pretentious, a demonstration of the technical superiority of Russia over NATO. So I believe it's very pretentious, but what is very interesting is that he said that this was a demonstration that the ABM a shield that is being installed in Eastern Europe and the other one in Asia could be a target for boost cruise missiles. So it reflects the Russian fear and the Russian anticipation that the United States could in the future chessmate Russia with the ABM shield. And this is part of their strategic messaging. Next slide. Well, if we look at our Western analysis, we have an interesting comment by an English, a British brigadier who said that this was again to call our attention on Russia, this demonstration by those missiles. Next slide. And if we look at the reality of the Russian capabilities in terms of cruise missiles, we realize actually that the USN still enjoy a considerable advantage over the Russians with 80 surface ships and 50 submarines, and on those 80 Aegis surface ships, they can launch between around 90 to around 120 furiously cruise missiles. So actually, you see that the Russian capabilities are very limited. You have only one new SSN, the only new SSN of a new class that was built after the Cold War, the Severodvinsk, with 24 missiles. You have indeed the new Kilo class, the construction has been restarted with 6 for the Black Sea and 6 for the Pacific Fleet, but so far you only have 5. And you have the new frigates, again. So far, there will be only 3 of the Gorshkov class and 3 of the Talwar class because of the gas turbine issue with Ukraine. So we are talking about a very limited number. Obviously, they have installed those missiles on the small corvettes, but the corvettes can carry only 8 missiles. So it's more of an optical, political illusion to give the impression to the world and also to the Russian public that Russia is on a par with the US, but it does not have the capabilities of the US in terms of cruise missiles. So, it's a surprise that should not have been a surprise, because all those programs were actually started during the Cold War. You see, if you look back, the program of the caliber was started in 1983, and it was the Russian answer to the Tomahawk. They were very afraid at the time, the Russians, that the United States would be able to defeat them at the conventional level by first strikes by Tomahawk. And so this was their answer at the time. And we see also another missile which is very important, which is the Onyx missile, which is actually the, I would say, the big brother of the Indo Russian BrahMos missile, but again, due to financial difficulties, the Russian version appeared in Russian service after the BrahMos entered service with the Indians. So we see that all those programs are old, I would say old programs, not new. So this is the Onyx missile, supersonic missile, which is used mainly for anti-ship, in an anti-ship role. And what is interesting with the Caliber missile, which actually belongs to the club family of missiles, is that it can be used in an asymmetrical role. You can carry it on a truck, on a train, in a container. You can put it on a merchant ship. You can put it on a landing ship. Of course, you have all the targeting issues, but they can use a helicopter for that. So actually, the Russians have many options with those missiles, and they can actually deploy them on a number of platforms to make for their lack of platforms. This is the main problem of Russia right now. And as I said, this missile, those missiles have already been exported. You see, you have the Club S in Algeria, India, Vietnam, China. You have the Bastion missiles, that's the version of the Onyx in Syria. And you have, of course, the Brahmos in India and Vietnam. And Indonesia purchased Onyx, or let's say the Bastion, the Yakont export version for one frigate. So, is there really a resurgent Russian naval threat? I would say that the numbers in the fleet, in the Russian fleet order of battle, are still going down, and the situation is not looking good. But they are compensating this big weakness by adding those missiles. If you look at the figures of the Russian Navy, it's quite obvious. If you look at the fact that now the Russian Navy is no longer the second Navy in the world, it's now the first Navy in the world, although it retains an advantage over the Chinese Navy in terms of nuclear submarines and the quality of the nuclear submarine. It's self-evident when you look at those figures. I don't intend to go into the details, but you can see very obviously in terms of SSGN, actually they have 7. In terms of SSN, they have 17, so it means 24. You know, they are way down the numbers they had in the Cold War when they had more than 150. If you look at their SSKs, you see that they are down to 20, so it's for them extremely urgent to build those kilos after the failure of their LADA program, to build those kilos for the Black Sea Fleet and for the Pacific Fleet. It's a stopgap measure for them. And if you look in terms of large combatants, right now they're down to one battle cruiser in service, and they have a program to refit them precisely with the Caliber and the Onyx missile. But in terms of destroyers, they have no new destroyers in construction. They have a project which should be led in 2019 of a very large destroyer leader, which will be about the size of a Zoom one, but which will be multi-purpose, I would say, like the Zoom one, and which will be a de facto replacement in the long term for the Slava cruisers, the Sovereign Mini destroyers, and also the Kirov. And the frigate program I mentioned is right now down because of that gas turbine issue with Ukraine. So they are trying to compensate by initiating a large production of small corvettes that, again, are a defensive platform because they don't plan to deploy them overseas. They are just in their periphery. So this is, again, what I said for the SSN program. It has been extremely slow, only one SSN of a new class since the end of the Cold War. There's several events. There will be 7 of them, and then it will move to a new class. It's a very slow program. And this is the stopgap measure that they can take. Especially, they've decided to build 18 of those corvettes, 22-800 that you see, because the problem of the other, the Guyane mode, that they are sea river corvette, so they are not very seaworthy. So this one, the 22800, is a seaworthy corvette, and this is a kind of a stopgap for the problem that they have met with the frigates. And they are also building OPVs, and those OPVs can be fitted with the caliber. So actually, all the ships we see here can be fitted with the caliber missile. So that's at the future, this very large platform. The modernization of the Oscar submarine, another stopgap measure, and they will be very potent because they will have about 80 anti-ship missiles instead of 24 right now. But again, a 30-year-old platform. And they are going to modernize the 8 Udaloy destroyers, but they are also 30-year-old platforms. So again, you see the situation is not looking good. But again, the missiles can be a game changer, because if we look at the future, this is what they have in their plans. So it's an hypersonic missile, which is their answer to the US Global Strike program. So again, this missile is even, I would say, more frightening than the caliber missile. And it's interesting to see that there is an export version and a cooperation with India, with BrahMos 2. So if we look at the rationale of Russia, I think that we have disregarded their strategic messaging that they have done in a number of documents, starting with the maritime doctrine, the military doctrine of 2000 after the Kosovo, and the maritime doctrine of 2001, which was actually the dissertation of Admiral Kuryedov that you see with Putin, President Putin. Putin attended the dissertations defended by Kuryedov, and this document, 42 pages, very clearly stated the Russian threat perception and the problem caused by NATO expansion. So that back in 2001. And obviously in the Far East at this time, the main problem was the imbalance. But if you look at the more recent 2015 military doctrine, the Russians, again, their main issue is the NATO expansion. It's also the West interventionism and generating terrorism. So the fact that the West has destabilized the Middle East, so this is for them another big concern. And also what they perceive, they are absolutely convinced that the West is behind the Kiev revolution, has supported the revolution, and they have taken that as an aggression against them. So it explains Crimea, it explains Eastern Ukraine. And if you look at Gorbachev's analysis, Gorbachev has been extremely unhappy in the current development. He didn't used to be a supporter of Putin, but more recently he has criticized the United States. He said, we are a country with a tremendous history, with diplomatic experience, and we have been ignored by the West. And actually, if you look at what George Kennan, who cannot be suspected of being soft on the Soviet, because he's actually the father of the containment policy, said not long before his death, he felt that expanding NATO would be the most fateful error of American policy in the entire post-Cold War era. Such a decision may be expected to inflame the nationalistic, anti-Western, and militaristic tendencies in Russian opinion, who have an adverse effect on the development of Russian democracy, to restore the atmosphere of the Cold War to East-West relations, and to impel Russian foreign policy direction decided not to our liking. So I believe that he anticipated everything in 1997. And if you look at the last U.S. ambassador to the Soviet Union, John Matlock, said, he also described very clearly the way the Russians are feeling. You know, and this is why right now President Putin enjoys such a support, when a lot of Russians are fed up with corruption and with his regime, but actually they believe that the West is against them, and that's why they unite around their leader. In conclusion, I would say those missiles were no surprise. The future of the Russian Navy remains very bleak, because in terms of platforms, they have the stopgap measures of modernizing very old platforms, but those platforms won't last more than another 10 years, you see, and they, so the numbers will further decline. But because they are facing this challenge, the fear of the ABM, the fear of the global strike, they will use the missiles. And you could call the missiles, indeed, in my view, a game changer for the future. And it's interesting to see that, of course, Russia has gotten closer to China, but it remains a very cosmetic alliance, if I may call it like that, because you see that at the same time, Russia, for financial reasons, but probably also for strategic reasons, has been supporting adversaries of China, Vietnam, mainly in this area, and also India, because more than 60% of the hardware in India is coming from Russia. And it's so interesting that Russia is giving India its new SSBN and all the technology for the SSBN, and also in terms of missile, for the hypersonic missile, Russian help to India for the BrahMos 2. So I would just like to ask a candid question to the audience. How many of you had read, let's say before 2014, the Russian Maritime Doctrine of 2001? You know, that's my question. Well, congratulations to those who read that doctrine. But I believe that the problem with Russia is that we've ignored their strategic messaging, we've ignored their military doctrines and maritime doctrines, the various documents. Unlike in Soviet days, where they were secretive about everything, the Russians have been actually quite open about their concerns, and I think we failed to address them. Right. Thank you.
So in just under an hour, we've had a tour de table on technology and the impact on, or potential impact on maritime doctrine operations. And my takeaway from the session tonight, there's 4 points that I wrote down. The first one is the impact of space-based communications and technology. And what that brings with it, of course, is the unbelievable complex problem of big data. It also introduces the notion of the potential to link naval forces in new ways in yet to be identified networks and control systems that the UAVs and unmanned systems are going to bring to us. We did not have the time in this brief introduction to even begin to explore the threats of cyber and the impact of third-party manipulation of those networks and control systems and the impact that that would have on maritime doctrine and operations. We also got a glimpse into budget cost and the impact on procuring traditional naval capabilities set against the requirement for offsets. In other words, technology isn't free. Do you want more technology and less gunnery? Do you want more gunnery, less technology? How will the maritime planners balance this budgetary space to stay relevant in the future? That also poses a whole issue that people in industry have been talking about for a long time, which is, how do you change procurement to stay relevant? Because a traditional 10-year RFP process won't do anybody any good, other than you will be guaranteed to field naval forces that are not technologically relevant, potentially not interoperable, and not very reliable. And then the final point, which is Russia back. And the proliferation of missile technology and the introduction of hypersonic missile systems has the potential to fundamentally change the entire nature of above water warfare and the entire corresponding supporting enablers of layered defense links, communications, all of those things. And so, while this panel has had the opportunity to just touch the wavetops, you can clearly see the technology is going to drive maritime doctrine operations, not only in the upcoming years, but for decades ahead. We have 30 minutes for questions. I think that there's a number of provocative ideas that have been placed before the audience. The panel would now be interested in taking your questions. Please introduce yourself.
Good morning. I'm Carrie Lynn Nankibble from the DKI Asia Pacific Center in Honolulu. Thanks to the presenters for three excellent discussions on some very complicated and complex topics. My question is about partnerships, and particularly in the United States, whether we're talking about the Global Maritime Partnership or Secretary Carter's Principled Security Network idea, the importance of partnerships is clearly on the rise in the thinking for the U.S. Navy. I think I was fascinated by David's comment about reducing the barriers to entry, at least in the space market, for some parts of the technology. But I'm interested in hearing from particularly David and George about whether or not new technologies offer leapfrogging opportunities for emerging navies. And will new technologies in space and unmanned systems make partnerships easier in the medium term or harder? Are we moving forward farther down the have and have not realm when we look across the Asia Pacific?
Fascinating question. Cost of partnership and the impact on relationships.
Thanks. Let's see, is that working yet? Yeah. On. How's that?
Still not there.
There we go. Okay. Excellent question. And particularly as we're seeing commercially driven space capabilities coming forward, it's going to enable countries that have not traditionally had access to high quality data from space for reasons of classification and national interest, a lot more capability, whether it's for planning things on land, for managing their own resources, and for cooperating with maritime domain awareness and control of shipping. Because when there's a widely available commercial plot that those who might have access to more sensitive data can point to, it's going to help drive that coordination. The other piece is space platforms, they circle the world, kind of self-evident. So if one nation is putting up something to provide a capability working with their national industry over their space, say Canada putting up space capabilities. On the backside of that orbit, absolutely, there's opportunities for other nations to buy in. That's not a D&D thing, that's a Canadian Space Agency thing. But this is an area that's opening up quite quickly, and watch it. It's going to take off in a big way.
Carrie, thank you for that question. I mean, to address directly your question about partnerships and what we can do, and again, I'm coming at this as a technologist primarily. Just over a decade since then, CNO Admiral Mullen introduced the concept of the Thousand Ship Navy with a Global Maritime Partnership, which is now morphed into the Global Network of Navies. Unless you solve the C4ISR issues between nations and make that same technology kind of a level baseline, in our view, there is no Thousand Ship Navy. So, kinds of things that we in the U.S. are working on. First of all, technology partnerships with many nations to share our technologies with them. We have things like Centrix that we put on allied ships for exercises like RIMPAC that I was well familiar with. But a lot of it is just for the U.S. to have more understanding. When you're on a Nimitz-class carrier, the big pipes and big lines, you can push around megabytes of data. When you're on a submarine or a frigate or a corvette, we have to understand better that the 20 megabyte PowerPoint that the Admiral saw at 9 o'clock in the morning is not going to make it to the other ship. So I think it's just leveling the playing field from a command and control and an IT perspective that we really can have a partnership that seamlessly exchange information.
Well, I don't know if from the Russian perception I can address your question, except that Russia indeed has tried to solve its financial difficulties with R&D, with cooperative programs, mainly with India, and with the BrahMos 1 and BrahMos 2. So that's what I would see as something that could correspond with your question.
Before we go to the next question, I'd just like to take Kerry's point and bring us back to a principle that Admiral MacDonald brought up yesterday, which is the notion that you cannot surge trust. And trust is a fundamental feature of the maritime partnership or the aspirations of a more unified approach to maritime strategies. And so for the panel, you didn't talk about how are we going to build trust with and sharing data in a way that everybody from the top to the smaller countries have an understanding or greater reliability or reliance or confidence, I guess, is the question, in the information that's being provided, recognizing that the outcome of technology could be quite significant. So any comments on trust in relation to Kerry's question?
Thank you for that. Good question. I guess the thesis I come back to is commercial space by establishing a base layer of positional awareness, situational awareness, provides a context that enable cooperation and partnerships. The assumption is everybody can see this picture because everybody has at least access to commercial grade data. And therefore, when sharing capabilities and saying, yeah, that flaw is me, this is the capability I've got, my intentions, and seeing through the plot that intentions are being carried through, that can help build trust. It's a bit of a sideways answer, unfortunately, but that's what I got at this point.
Yeah, well, thanks for that comment. So two things on that. Number one, it's working, and again, going back to Apple Summer Readership's quote, it's working at a collaboratory level. David and I were talking before the panel started that we have a program called the Technical Cooperation Program, which is the Five Eyes Nations, which is sharing information and working on projects at the laboratory level with scientists and engineers. And then a lot of it is to your point, is opening the window and letting people see what's really going on. For example, our lab has information exchange agreements with over 20 nations. We're at the scientists and engineer program. We're very open kimono about it, what we're working on and what that capability will bring. So when it's introduced to the fleet some years later, there are not a lot of surprises. That's where I think a lot of that trust can come.
Thank you. Next question.
All right, thank you. Good morning. My name is Brad Pilsel. I'm from Booz Allen Hamilton out of San Diego, California. A couple of trends that we've heard over yesterday and today. One, technology is probably outpacing end user awareness in a lot of fronts, and the ability to get ahead of the requirement cycle, the budget cycle, to drive a lot of things from the industry side. There's also a desire on the part of many of the U.S. end users, at least, and that's across the spectrum. When we talked yesterday about maritime, not only navies, but fishing enforcement, law enforcement, they want us to invest heavily R&D far to the left of the requirement cycle. So that creates a little bit of tension on the industry side. So how do you guys recommend that us in industry best get our technology into the hands of the end users? Thank you.
Updating technology?
So no, thanks for that question. I think, and I'm coming at this from the Spaywar world, which is C4ISR, which is we rarely get to wait for an RFP, request for proposal. We have to anticipate user demands. Not to tell you too much about the lab, but as our commanding officer has all the returning carrier strike group commanders come back through the lab and talk about their experiences and their IT questions and issues and those sorts of things. And inevitably, there's a question from one of our engineers to the Strike Group commander saying, well, Admiral, what do you want your next C4ISR system to look like? And usually the answer, and these are very smart, upwardly mobile people, usually the answer is, I have no idea. You guys are designed for us. And it's so much different from the aviation and the surface and subsurface world where you can write down a proposal. So I think to answer your question, a lot of it is industry helping the government write those proposals and anticipate needs that we don't think we don't know we need yet.
I echo some of that and reflect a comment that I picked up at a conference last week in Washington. In many places, things have changed from military meeting the technical requirements to military harnessing what's happening in the commercial sector. And in particular, one program manager describing his decision-making process, he said, I'm not interested in projects that would not be viable commercially. If the sole customer is military, he said, I'm not interested because we don't have enough money to push into everything that the military and security communities are going to need. So an answer to the question of where should we invest, where would you get investors to back you to invest? What's happening in data analytics is not driven by a military requirement. It's a huge leap ahead happening, and it's all being driven by commercial and business requirements and a business model that says, hey, there's value in this information, there's a business model for value added to existing data structures, and that's stimulating the global innovation system. And that's where a lot of those leap aheads are coming. There's always going to be niche places where, yes, indeed, there are military-specific requirements. There are four where those are identified. But the vast majority is, think about things that would make sense in business anyway and possibly have a military application.
Next question. Please speak into the mic. We're having difficulty hearing up here.
Thank you very much. Three excellent presentations. I've got a question for Dave and a question for Alexander. Dave, you didn't touch on the issue of what happens and how vulnerable are we to the collapse of the satellite system, given something, you know, following the Chinese shooting down of their satellite from a maritime asset and popularized, with movies such as Gravity. Can you talk, especially with commercial expanding into that zone, how dangerous is that as a threat to all these systems you talk about, and what type of efforts are now underway to allow us to recover from such problems? And for Alexander, I was just wondering if perhaps you could elaborate a little bit on some of the moves towards developing, particularly on the naval side, perhaps the United States Navy or even the Norwegians with the updating of their Aegis system, of a maritime-based AVN system, and how that then factors into some of the Russian thinking, particularly along the lines of the doctrine that you've outlined.
Let's start off with Dave. Are flags and light communications coming back?
Yes.
Thanks, Rob. You raise a good point. It's certainly something that has many people fretting. Space-based navigation, space-based communications is almost too easy, and I hinted at that in the presentation. Vulnerabilities, yeah, they're real. Whether it's space weather, cosmic flares, those sorts of things, an accidental collision or intentional actions. The result is the satellites that are on orbit, they're basically undefended. They're up there, they're doing their thing. There's minor capability to move around. But yeah, you don't want to be dependent on that single point. Hence the question of what's the reliable backup. I think back to a Westpac conference from a couple of years ago when a U.S. leader said it's not a question of if we lose SATCOM in conflict, but when. And therefore, making sure that we have robust communication capabilities, robust ISR capabilities that you can fight through from a naval perspective. It's not that different than other fog of war issues. You don't go into a fight assuming you're going to have all the capability you had there to start. You put contingencies in. You make sure that you're still exercising HF comms, and you've got people maintaining a manual plot, because if and when those things go away. The bigger concern is on the commercial side, where there is, driven by the economies of keeping transit costs down, there's incredible reliance on that. If global navigation systems went down, not only would ships at sea have trouble, aircraft would have trouble, and the banking system would have trouble, because they currently rely on GPS for precise timing to enable banking transactions. That infrastructure resilience is a significant concern. People are thinking about it. I don't have a magic answer in my back pocket, but thanks for bringing it up.
Thank you. Yes, the Russians are thinking now in terms of aerospace defense for their future platform. They even suggest that their future 100,000 tons aircraft carrier, we don't know when that will become reality, because it will be probably after the 2013, but will be capable also of launching perhaps small satellites, you see. So they want to integrate the possibility to defend against the ABM, obviously, and then in the future against the global strike, the US global strike systems. And the Russians, in that sense, what we perceive as the A2AD, or as the Russian degree, very unpleasant, because they do have the capability now with cruise missiles to strike at a long distance. But again, in their perception, this is their defense. Again, our new capabilities that they see as targeted against them.
Next question, please.
Tim Choi from the University of Calgary. I want to go back to a point that David raised a couple of questions ago, and it was more about the relationship between civil and military R&D and technology development. And of course, we all know that historically speaking, it's usually military R&D who leads the way with the technology that gets assimilated down to civilian sectors. But of course, in recent times, there's been a notable change in this regard that goes the other way. Soldier system trying to integrate iPhones and all that good works into their own combat systems. And I'm just wondering, to what extent is that still applied in the maritime realm? And each of three of you in your special areas, do you see that occurring in your organizations, if that applies? And what are some of the risks and opportunities of having this shift, if it does exist, from civilian towards the military side of technology? Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. That's a really relevant question, particularly as science and technology budgets have been capped and reduced. Where do we invest? How do we effectively coordinate between leveraging what's being done in the commercial sector and making sure that you're investing in the specific military capabilities that are most important and that the commercial sector is not going to pick up on? I gave no magic answer. We spend a lot of time road mapping, say, overall, this is where things are going. It looks like commercial technology is going here. Maybe there are places where we provide nudges. And then over on this piece, these are the military specific bits that nobody else is going to pick up on, and therefore investments are required there. And that's also a place, getting back to the partnership question earlier, that we tend to work at as a club. So if there's a tough problem, like-minded nations divide it up and we each take on a piece. So I don't know if that's a perfect answer, but it's kind of where we're coming from. Yeah,
well, thanks for that. I mean, this gets right to what came up earlier about the minimum investment R&D that our Departments of Defense can make right now, and how industry is leading the way. One thing that our U.S. DoD has done under Secretary Carter is we recognize that a lot of the technology we need are being designed and built in Silicon Valley. So we've established something called DIUX, Defense Innovation Unit Experimental. It's right up at the old Moffett Field in Silicon Valley, and the whole purpose of that organization is to borrow best practices from the the dot-com industry, if you will, and help us integrate into those industries and find solutions to the issues we have today. So I think that's one of those initiatives that recognizes that that's where the innovative part is going on today.
But that raises a question. When you look at the relationship of commercial industry and how commercial industry is structured, commercial industry is not as sovereign as military forces or naval forces are. And so that begins to drive a whole new approach or a demand for a new approach for how you're going to approach R&D with commercial industry, but commercial industry is structured very, very differently than governments, nations, national R&D efforts. And the other point that sort of emerges from that brief discussion is not everybody can afford to invest in Silicon Valley, which has an impact directly back to Kerry's question on trust partnerships and how are we going to deal with technology in a way that you get this level playing field that Dave is talking about. Next question.
Good morning. This is Captain Keizo Kitaba from Japanese Microsoft Defense Force. Thank you very much for the informative presentation. I have a question for Professor Alexandre. As well as the participants here, Russia is a very good customer for our business for Japan. And I was very impressed how they tried to compensate the decline in the shipbuildings by making compensated by missiles. My question to you is during the Cold War, they have the Warsaw Pact. They have various countries to compensate each other. On the other hand, currently Russia is Russia. And you mentioned in your presentation they sell the goods, for example, to India, Vietnam, or China. But I think it is the one-way flow of the technology and so forth. But to prevent their decline, how the Russia will come back is first financially, and secondly with the technology or production-wise. So in order to do that, legally for us, we do cooperate with countries or several industries. Do you have any idea how they do their business from now on? Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Yes, Russia had a huge problem in the 1990s, which was financial, and which was also the explosion of a system which integrated the wall of the Soviet Union, because in the 1990s they had to pay in our currencies for the Ukrainian turbine, they had to pay for a number of other systems. So in the aftermath of the Cold War, Russia had to develop a number of skills within its own territory. In the case of the gas turbines, there is a plant in Yaroslav which should, in the future, provide the famous gas turbine. But so far, it has not happened, you see. So, but Russia has tried in the 1990s to survive and was able to survive thanks to China and thanks to India, because they kept the shipbuilding industry active. But then, in the aftermath, Russia has a technological problem, because most of the R&D for the system that we are seeing now was done and financed in the 1980s, so still at the time of the Soviet Union. So Russia is trying to learn, of course, from us, has benefited from a number of venture. If you take the case of the Mistral contract, why they wanted to buy those helicopter carriers in France, there was one reason, which was to make us happy, so to improve the relation, that's for sure. There was a second motive, which was to demonstrate within the Russian shipbuilding industry that if the Russian shipbuilding industry was not able to deliver on time, the state could place orders abroad, you see. So this was a kind of a threat. The third reason, which was also very important, was to improve the shipbuilding techniques, because actually the shipbuilding techniques are still very, very old and very obsolescent. So they were hoping to modernize the shipyard with the Mistral contract.
and even to build a very large shipyard in Kronstadt that could later on be involved in the carrier project. But that has gone down, and the future carrier will be built most likely in several events.
Okay, we're down to our last two questions at the microphone. Admiral.
Great, Art McDonald, thanks Kelly for that. And three outstanding presentations, great way to kick off the morning, and even better moderation there by Kelly as he tries to connect the dots. It actually was fantastic, and I want to connect the dots building on what you've done. The presentations all tickled my funny bone from a point of view of having been the chief architect of our future force in the Canadian Navy in my previous job, and now as a force generator here on the coast in my current job. So I want to pick up on a theme, and I thank you for raising it, George. It was excellent. It's the cost of unmanned systems in terms of people, which we often don't explore, and it's a hidden piece in here. And that ties back to what you've been doing so well, Kelly, which is connecting themes across the conference. So I don't have so much a question, but a little bit of a rant over about 45 seconds here, which probably means about 10 minutes. Then I'll just put it out for some questions. But if you connect the themes from yesterday, and I'll, of course...
Just a second.
So where we're at here is Admiral Swift talked about the challenge of comparing, is our business about technology or about people? And of course, like him, and I think most of the other admirals will talk about being a tech-enabled but people-delivered business. And of course, the importance of getting that people right. I think people are our most robust weapon system. It also costs a lot of money, but that's that gives us the robustness to be adaptive as we go forward. So comparing and connecting some of the dots from yesterday, we've got this people versus technology theme. We've got the great discussion we had on strategy yesterday, the constant need to revise and adapt them because things are always changing, versus technology potentially being able to solve one unique problem, you know, the Russian missile piece, strictly in the anti-air warfare, above water warfare realm and so on. Coming back to relationships, I mean, when you think of maritime versus naval, another debate we had yesterday, what are some of these technological answers going to do outside of the naval realm with respect to some of the much bigger picture things that navies in the world, coast guards in the world are involved with now, which is, of course, much broader than a particular problem that a single technology solution can fix. So I think it's a great dialogue that we've raised here today about the true cost of these unmanned systems, because as our business gets larger and larger and more complex, there is a demand to be as efficient and effective as possible, and often decision makers are seduced by all of us because we present them with a technological solution to a particular problem. We get it, it works fine, only to find that the world has moved off that point and presented us with a new problem for which we're ill-prepared. That is where the robustness of our best operational capability, our best weapon system, our people comes in, because we are the most adaptive weapon and operation systems on the planet. And I know that we all take that perspective. Can you give me, in light of the kind of questions that you've been asking, Kelly, surging trust and whatnot, how you think we should square that circle in terms of making a full presentation of the cost of unmanned systems and technology and its utility to decision makers in, you know, 15 to 20 seconds each?
So let's focus the response into people, cost, and technology. What are your comments on squaring those three points?
Yeah, well, it's not an either or. So sometimes people, when you talk about technology, they say, oh, you don't need people or people aren't important. That's not the point. I think it's how we incentivize industry. I was in acquisition command early in my career, and you learn on the first day of acquisition school, it's a three-legged school, cost, schedule, and performance. But the reality, as most of you in industry know, is years after the system is fielded, people forget about the cost, they have no idea the schedule. You in industry, as well, you should worry about the performance. So I'll give you an example with the Fire Scout autonomous system we introduced on a littoral combat ship. The people who manufactured this Fire Scout, and good friends of mine, they wanted this to succeed. So they envisioned their own control system, their own maintainers, all the people who came with the Fire Scout, which would add lots of people to the littoral combat ship, and they couldn't be housed. So the decision had to be driven to let the people with the H-60 system on board, the pilots and the maintainers, they would take care of the Fire Scout, they would operate the Fire Scout. From industry perspective, that wasn't the greatest answer, but it was the answer that would work. So we just had to compromise.
Dave, comment?
Sure. I guess the first thing is the observation, for example, with unmanned air systems, there's been a lot of commentary, hey, we only need to put one pilot in there, but why does it take five or six people to run this aircraft? That's now. It's not the steady state. We're looking at an emerging technology that is going to acquire more autonomous capability. That's the promise, hopefully. It will come there. So the first one is don't judge future costs by what's going on in the interim state. The second thing is, and I'm from an S&T organization, so of course I'm going to say this, you got to invest in experimentation. It's not just enough to acquire the technology, to write a spec and go, hey, there it is, go at it. Pre-acquisition, during acquisition, bringing a new capability aboard, particularly autonomy, fundamentally changes the way we fight, and you gotta work that out ahead of time. That's when you come up with the concepts of operations that have been tested. And then eventually, yeah, it's expensive stuff, but initially, tabletop exercises. You've got to start thinking these things through. And as much effort as we put into the acquisition, we have to put a corresponding amount of effort into sorting out the concept. And finally, watch what's going on in the commercial and civilian space. Military, autonomous vehicles, everybody in the room is paying attention to it. There's a whole civilian market starting to open up, and they're going to explore different approaches to operating those craft, dealing with the data, and there's going to be lessons to be learned there.
Any comment from a Russian perspective, Alexander?
Well, so far, I don't think that the Russians are so much into reducing the crews as we are. And they have always had a culture of a fighting platform that must survive the hits, and therefore they always like duplication, you know, having two CIC on the platform, I mean, etc. And I think they still have a bit of that culture in that country. But obviously, the issue of people and cost is important. I think it's very important for their military industry. They had a problem to get new engineers, especially in the 1990s. So I think, again, for R&D, I don't know what will the future bring to the Russians, because they have had a gap compared to the Soviet Union.
And the final question.
Hi, I'm Rear Admiral Scott Bishop. I'm a commander of Canadian Forces Intelligence Command. And I would just echo all the comments. The panel this morning was fantastic, and I would say the same about all the panels that I've had the privilege to listen to over the last couple of days. My question is directed primarily to George, and I was really happy to listen to your brief and have you talk about artificial intelligence, because although we talk a lot about the rise of autonomous vehicles, I personally feel that the transformative technology going forward is artificial intelligence, because that's the technology that is going to enable more autonomy in our weapon systems, but it's also going to have cross-cutting impacts across the entirety of the way we do business as warfighters. It's going to be the key to being able to harness all of the massive amounts of data that are available for exploitation. Artificial intelligence is probably going to be the key to significantly leverage space and cyber-based domain weapon systems and sensors. And I guess what I would say is, in your presentation, George, you talked about putting a limit on artificial intelligence and how it's employed in military systems. And I wanted to get an idea from you of how realistic that is going to be in practice. When you take a look at what's going on in artificial intelligence right now, massive amounts of investments are being made, not only by governments, but also by the private sector. The rate of change has just been incredible in artificial intelligence systems. And I guess what I would ask fundamentally is, do you think that we are already late to need on a larger discussion internationally about the ethics of artificial intelligence and autonomous systems of warfare?
So before we, because this is the final question, it's a fabulous question that sort of wraps up the whole issue of technology and the impact on maritime doctrine operations, as well as partnerships. So I would ask you guys to each sort of summarize the question on the impact of artificial intelligence set against technology in your closing comments, and give you all each of them like a minute to sort of wrap that up.
Well, thank you for that question. I mean, I think you really hit the key question as we develop autonomous systems over time. So there's no question, I think, we want to harness artificial intelligence to use it to our benefit. I will tell you that within the U.S. Department of Defense, our Secretary of Defense, Carter, has made it crystal clear that for autonomous systems that have lethal capability, the human will be in the loop, not on the loop, maybe checking in, but in the loop, making that firing decision. So I think the art of this is using that artificial intelligence to inform the warfighter to help he or she make better decisions faster with fewer people and fewer mistakes. I mean, a lot of the work at our lab went back to the tragic incident there of shootouts. How did that happen? When humans in the loop, they made mistakes. They didn't use the systems to their advantage. So I hope I don't portray that on anti-artificial intelligence. What I'm suggesting is that artificial intelligence has to be used as a way to reform the warfighter, so he or she makes that final decision whether to use the capability to inform with the best information as possible.
Alexander, how about
you
to close off the tape
for us? On the Russian side, if we look at artificial intelligence or autonomous vehicle,
yes, they are working on it. They are designing new UAVs and UUVs. They bought an Austrian UAVs, and as we know, they have devised, it's also very important to note, a new strategic system called the Canyon. You know, they plan to circumnavigate the ABM problem by having a very long-range torpedo on two future submarines, the Khabarovsk and I can't remember the other, which is the Moscow Mod, so that they could torpedo, for instance, New York, with about, the torpedo would be fired about 12 or 16 hours before hitting its target. So it would be a kind of an autonomous system by itself. So the Russians are giving importance to that.
And Dave, final comments?
Sure. Autonomy, particularly thinking about the ISR piece, it's really that's the answer to dealing with the deluge of data. Old models where you'd have a dedicated analyst looking at it at a particular site just don't work. There are too many things to look at, too much data, and not enough analysts. So the place of autonomy is in maintaining a watch on particular things with decision points that say, hey, if you see this happen, if you see three ships at this jetty, send an alert because it means we need to take a second look at it. And when things are starting to happen in closer timelines, thinking out of the satellite space into my older space in supporting maritime operations, where timelines are much tighter in a surface warfare scenario, providing the alert and the COAs saying, okay, it looks like you've got threats coming at you from here, here, and here. Your decision time is the next X seconds. These are the options in front of you. And like you saw at Corral's at RIMPAC, that kind of capability that enables the warfighter to focus on the critical decisions that need to be made. So picking up on preparing the information and basically briefing the human operator. In the end, we need to have humans in the loop, not just because of the concern about robot vehicles going awry, but also to preserve the agility that we need in the battle space coming forward. You cannot possibly conceive of everything that's going to come at you, and so therefore you cannot possibly program in sufficient options into an AI. What you need to do is focus on getting the right information in front of the most agile component of a warfighting system, and that's the operator, and allow the operator to do his job.
Well, that completes this panel, and like the baseball game last night, we had to go a couple extra innings just to get it all in. But on behalf of the Navy League and Commander Lloyd of the Royal Canadian Navy, I would like to thank Dave, George, and Anatole for their contributions today, and to stimulating what I thought was a provocative and interesting discussion. So on behalf of the collection here and those assembled, thank you very, very much for your time, your insights, and your participation today.